I hope you are able to see the screen. Everyone, screen is visible and am I audible? Both these questions.
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So I'm going to talk about the brief history of how Indian or ancient Indian maths evolved. And of course, it's a huge time span. So whatever time is available right now with us, I just want to, you know, quickly go through this. So this is the content of today's session. I want to explore this historical perspective. Then there are various Indian texts are available in the span of 2000 or 3000 years. And those various Indian texts gives us rich inputs in terms of mathematics, astronomy, and various methods were there. And it also gives us civilization and cultural aspects of Indian progression in this field. And of course, there are important inventions, and I'm going to talk about which were the key techniques which were used by ancient astronomers and mathematicians for their practical applications in day-to-day life. And again, what was the world view regarding this Indian maths by various experts in this field. So as we go and as we start discussing about ancient mathematics, we can't just ignore Vedas. So this is the Yajurved, and in Yajurved, if I tell you that this is nothing but one of the Adhyaya 18 and Kandika 2. Kandika means second Richa or the second Shloka, and it is the Shloka about Imame Agna Ishtaka. So a seeker or the Medhatmi Rushi, Medhatithi name of the Rushi, he is requesting Agni to give these many number of cows and milk giving cows in this world and also in other worlds. This is the meaning, and all these numbers like Dasha, Shata, Sahastra, Sahastrayuta, Niyuta, these are nothing but the number system names or the name given to different place values, and therefore it goes to 10 raised to up to 11. And I can say this is the names we can find in Yajurveda. So decimal system is very much part of the Vedic culture that we can prove from this particular stanza of Yajurveda, where Yajurveda generally deals about all technology required to perform yajna, and this is particular phrase from Yajurveda. Then this is the entire timeline starting from 1500 BC till Ramanujam, and after Ramanujam there are certain mathematicians like Kabrekar. Also I will mention Subramanyam Chandrasekhar, who has done contribution in the Chandrasekhar limit, which is again the mathematical formula. It was used in the black hole theory. So up to this and up to recently also we see contributors are there around the world from Indian subcontinent and giving their inputs in various fields of maths as well as astronomy. So if I want to go, this is the very early text which we find where Pythagoras theorem is proved by different methods, is from Shalva Sutra. Now there were four different designers of the Shalva Sutra: Budhayan, Manava, Apastamba and Katayan. And these four authors of the Shalva Sutra, and the exactly the period is not known, but around 1500 BC. Then we have this Bakshali manuscript, for which I will tell you the story about it, how it is invented, and I will also go through some methods of Bakshali manuscript. Then we have the brilliant scholars like Aryabhatta, Brahmagupta, Mahaviracharya. You can see the time periods is in 250 years. Every 200 and 250 or 300 years, we can see these people writing these very big, very authentic mathematics in terms of Aryabhatiya, Brahmasputta Siddhanta, Gadita Sara Sangraha, and the Bhaskaracharya comes, which is the his books are there for whole century, people are using it. And the basic mathematics or the everyday mathematics he has put in a very beautiful poems and different examples, which is a Leelavati and Bijagadita. And then the center of mathematics shifted towards South India, and we can see many people from South India like Shankar Variyar, Madhav, Nilkantha Somayaji, Jeshtha Deva, and Ganesh Devadnya is from Maharashtra, who has written the Grantha called Graha Laghav, which is the astronomical. He has written that Grantha at the age of 13 years old, that book, and he is a brilliant in astronomy, and he has written some very important formulas and proofs in maths as well. So this is the brief timeline of different mathematicians in India, and let us see what were the inventions all these texts gives us. So of course, discovery and use of zero, we don't know who discovered it, but as you can see in Vedic literature itself, existence of zero is there. Not only that, it has been used in a wide sense, and it has been told that zero and the infinity are just the two sides of a coin. So there is a so much deep perception of zero and infinity. So these are some of the in different types of inventions. Lot of work has been done on fractions, ratio proportion, loans, interest. As we can see here, all this is related to business and trade. So many methods are evolved with the help of trade, which was there in entire Middle East and European part and Africa. And I will show you the trade map which was there in the ancient India. So these are Pythagoras theorem was there in the Buddhayana. All the geometry was evolved due to the temple architecture, building temples, and of course very deep study of astronomy and motions of planets. So therefore we see that the sign ratio was there in a vast application of sine and pi was there to build certain structures, and a lot of Euclidean geometry is there, like finding the area of a cyclic quadrilateral or finding the area of a circle or finding drawing perfect squares, perfect rectangles, so which was required for building architecture and temples. So we can see all that is happening. And now this is the formulas which were there in the modern mathematics, like interpolation, power series of Newton, Gregory series or inverse tangent function. It was there with Madhavacharya. Newton's power series was there, and it was there in Somayaji's literature, and Newton-Gauss interpolation was also there in Govind Swami's Grantha. So, and of course I can say that Gadita Yukti Bhashya was the Grantha where just the beginning of calculus was there. I will not say that advanced level of calculus was achieved, but they got the little glimpse that we have to use calculus where both the things are changing with respect to each other. And we can see that Meru Prastar or the Pascal triangle we can find. Fibonacci series, now we know by the name of Fibonacci, but it was there in the Chanda Shastra of Pingala, where he used Fibonacci series to create the poem or create the binary numbers. So there is a huge relation between poetry, how to build the poetry, that is we call as the Chanda Shastra, which is the linguistic part, and again the coding of numbers, which is a binary, and Pingala is supposed to be the father of the binary language, and he was discovered that binary language with the help of Meru Prastar. So now this is the picture of Bakshali manuscript. So it happens that Bakshali is a town in the current Pakistan, 40 kilometers from Peshawar. So there was one police officer, Mia Anwan Uddin, and who used to, who has given his land for cultivation for one farmer. It happened in 1881 that this farmer has discovered some big trunk in the underground while he was cultivating the land, and he thought there was a treasure. But there was this manuscripts written in Sharada Lipi, and these manuscripts he gave it to Lieutenant Governor of that time, and Lieutenant Governor gave it to Rudolf Hamel. Rudolf Hamel was a researcher in ancient texts and especially manuscript expert, and then he revealed what is there inside, and he was amazed to see that lot of mathematics is there. Afterwards there is a carbon dating and what is the exact timeline of this manuscript. So it has been proved by Mr. Gurjar that with evidence that these are the manuscript belong to between 200 BC to 200 AD. So the language is used is Gatha and the script is Sharada. Gatha was the language which was there in the northeast part of the India, and it's around Pakistan, Afghanistan, Punjab, and the language died in 300 AD. So we can see that it is afterwards it has turned to Devanagari now. So this is the one which I am going to show you. This is a trade route, and through the trade route actually all methods of Indian calculations transferred to European region, Arabia and Africa. So these were the famous ancient trade route, and we can see that entire trading, when the trading used to take place or the lending of money used to take place, they have to calculate interest rates, and Indians are supposed to be very quick in calculating interest rates. And what is the method they use is the decimal system method, and then they realize from the Middle East, Arabia people realize that we have to learn these methods of doing regular trade or keeping accounts, and therefore Brahmagupta is afterwards. Brahmagupta is the one who was always in the limelight for 100 years. He has written Brahmasputa Siddhanta at the age of 30, where it has, and he has written another one, Khanda Khadya, which is age at 65. Both these particular work of Brahmagupta is actually based on Khagol Shastra, astronomy as well as mathematics. So Brahmasputa Siddhanta contained 24 chapters. Out of that, 12 to 18 chapters were on mathematics, and 18 chapter especially of algebra, and 12 chapter especially of arithmetic and mensuration. And entire grantha or entire literature was written in the terms of poetry or shlokas. So what was the contribution of Brahmagupta? He has given Heron's rule. Actually he has given the rule for finding out the area of a cyclic quadrilateral using semi-perimeter technique, and now the whichever is the Heron's rule we use for the area of a triangle, it is a special case of Brahmagupta's formula of cyclic quadrilateral. Then there is a formula of Newton-Stirling based on which gives the interpolation. Now that formula is called as Brahmagupta-Newton formula. And major contribution is solving Pell's equation, nx square plus 1 equal to y square, which is called as a Pell's equation, quadratic variables both x square and y square, and based on this only one equation you have to find out the solution, and Brahmagupta solved that equation. So therefore we see that Brahmagupta's work was very influential. Around 762 AD there was a Baghdad city which was located or which was formed, or I can say that the Baghdad has become the capital of Arabia that time. And in 773 AD, there was one Brahman from Ujjain whose name was Kank. And he was invited to Arabia and he has given this two particular work of Brahmagupta and was translated that time by Al-Fazari. The name of those Granthas are Sindhind and another is Al-Arkand. So these are the Al-Arkand and Sindhind is nothing but an Arabic translation of Brahmasphut Siddhanta and Khandakadya. Then Brahmagupta was very smart. Why I am saying that? Because people of Arabia or people which are in business, all of them apart from Indian subcontinent, they are not aware about zero. And if they are not aware about zero, they are also not aware about negative numbers. So what has happened that he has given the rules of basic mathematics in terms of debt and fortune. So we can say that debt minus zero is debt, fortune minus zero is fortune, zero minus zero is zero. So he has written this rule in terms of the language of business, so that everyone can understand it and there is no ambiguity regarding zero. There was a lot of ambiguity and confusion in Middle East and in Arabia, especially regarding zero. It is considered to be a very since it is a very secretive symbol and it has got lot of misconception attached to it. And therefore, he has to introduce the rules of mathematics without mentioning the ambiguity of zero or with in the language of businessman. So that's why this is the way he has introduced zero and negative numbers in terms of this language. Now everyone knows Khalif al-Mansur, who is responsible for taking this entire work of Brahmagupta to Arabia. And Abu al-Khwarizmi, now they call it as the father of algebra, but basically he has done the translation of Brahmasphuta Siddhanta and the algebraic part of it in Arabic, and whatever work he has done, it was translated to Latin as Algorithmi De Numero Indorum. So algorithm or the algebra arrived from India through Arabic, so we can call it that way. Now this is a Leonardo Fibonacci. So after Arabia, we know that through Fibonacci, the entire number system traveled or moved to Europe, and he has written the Liber Abaci, the famous book of Fibonacci, which was a standard book for next 200 years, and he got the big prize from the king, that the wonder of the world. He was called as a wonder of the world by the king which was there that time. So Fibonacci was responsible for taking all decimal system to Europe, and of course with sign zero. So this is the way we can see that through trade relation, through our entire trade with Arabians, how it traveled to Europe. Now we are going to see some methods which are there in Bakshali manuscript and of course in other literature available. So now this is the particular technique which was used to find the root of irrational number, rather root of a number which is not a perfect square. So suppose I want to find root of 37. This is the formula given, and of course there is no proof that how that formula is arrived or derived. So we can take this as a plus r is the extension or the excess So suppose 37 is we want to find the root, then 37 can be split as the known square, which is a square of 6, 36 plus 1. So our value of A becomes 6 and value of R becomes 1. So R upon 2A can be taken as a constant K, which we can find. So A plus K minus K square upon 2 in the bracket A plus K. We can use that formula and we can evaluate this to find the square root. A very beautiful formula. It has got very simple to do calculations, and such type of various formulas we can see in Bakshali manuscript, where especially they have to deal with square roots of our numbers which are not perfect squares. And so this is a formula, and I have checked this. This is up to 4 to 5 digits. It is correct to actual calculator figure. So you can check on your calculator whether this answer is correct, and you can write down this formula, and you can take any other number later on and check whether it holds to that number. I have tried it many times, so you can also try. I have tried with many numbers. Now similarly, when I say Bodhayan, why they need to find especially root 2 ka answer or root 2 value of the root 2, because Bodhayan Shalva Sutra is related to finding out hypotenuse of a perfect square. So every time hypotenuse of the perfect square is always A root 2. So we need to have a value of root 2. So this is a particular shloka or the particular phrase in Bodhayan Shalva Sutra, which tells us how to find the value of root 2. So pramanam trutiyena vardhaye tascha chaturthe nama chatushrin shonena sa visheshaha. Now your sa visheshaha is the word, especially in Sanskrit, tells us about the approximate value. So they were knowing that it is an approximate value. So pramana trutiyena means taking 1/3. Vardhayeta means adding 1/4, multiplying 1/4 to 1/3. Chaturthe natmacha chatushri shonena. Natmacha means multiplying again to the same number by 1/34. So whatever answer you get is nothing but. Now the explanation of this particular proof is given by Nilkantha and explain the description of this formula. So Nilkantha Somayaji has explained or tried to explain how this formula must have arrived in his literature. Now of course we can see Brahmagupta has derived this particular small, simple, concise way of remembering the sign table. We know that we require sign of a standard angles of 0, 30 degree, 45, 60 and 90. So if we take that sequence 0 to 90, similarly we take the sequence of 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 upon 4. So sign 0 is root 0 upon 4, which is 0. Sin 30, you take the next number, root 1 upon 4, that is plus or minus half. Sin 45, root 2 upon, so it is root 2, so it is 1/√2, which we can see plus or minus 1/√2. So like this, you can obtain all trigonometric formula by just remembering this one simple formula. And Brahmagupta had also given this sign rule and the identities, and also Bhaskaracharya given this compound angle formula in his literature. Now this is a one Bhaskar one, 600 AD. He has, again the proof of this formula is not known. 180 minus theta is taken as a standard multiplier. So 4 theta into 180 minus theta, 40,500 minus theta times 180 minus theta will give the sine of any angle theta. So finding sine was very important that time, because once we get sine ratio, we can get all remaining ratios easily. So this is a comparison between sine obtained by Bhaskar's formula up to 0 to 90 and actual value of sine and Bhaskara's rule. So this is the way we can see the comparison, and we see that it is more or less very much same. Little bit error occurs at the fourth, third and fourth digit, but up to two digit we can say that it is approximately more or less it matches with the current figure. Okay, now this is a Varaha Mihira's, again very interesting square he has given. Now this is called as a magic square, because if you can see that it's a 4 by 4 square, and so you can see that 2, 3, 5, 8, 5, 8, 2, 3, 4, 1, so this is a 4 by 4 square, means row addition, column addition, and even addition of diagonals is coming same. So, shodashake kachha pute yatha tatha mishrite chatur dravye. But this is not the magic square. This is a recipe. This is a recipe of or making perfume given in Brihat Samhita. So, you have to, there is a particular proportion of these different components like grass oil, bay leaves, wood oil, Franklin's resin, lichen flakes, lemongrass leaf. So these are the different compounds which are used in the proportion of 16 substances, and in the 16 proportions, and if you mix them you will get the perfume. So basically this is a, as I say, it is a collaboration of different subjects. Here they are telling the recipe of perfume making, giving the name of different types of substances available in nature, and telling them in the proportion of magic square to mix it to make a perfume. So I think this is a very it tells you the evolved way of thinking in terms of mathematics. I'm always amazed by this particular abilities that they show. Okay, I think my, hello, am I audible?
Yes, Prajapati.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, thank you. Okay, now the next method is given by Ganesh Devadnya. Ganesh Devadnya, actually, this method was quite famous in Europe in 1478 by the name of Gelosia in Italy. Gelosia is the phrase used for windows design, or the grill which was fixed on window. So this particular design is actually it's a design like a grill. So I will just explain you how it is done. Suppose this is the 879 and 610, we have to take the multiplication of, so we have to take this multiplication. So we use 3 by 3 square, and this, first of all we draw like square like this, which is 3 by 3, and afterwards we draw diagonals, and we write the numbers 879 like this, 879 and 695, and we can take the multiplication of 8 and 6, which is 48, 7 times 6 is 42, 9 times 6 is 54, 8 times 9 is 72, 7 times 9 is 63, like that. And when I complete this, of course there are no these numbers, I will tell you how to obtain these numbers. Whatever the diagonals are there, once you complete the table with this multiplication, you take the addition of these diagonals in the sideways. From the diagonal you take the addition, like diagonal of this section, addition of this section is 5. Addition of this section is 5 plus 4 plus 1, that is 10, 0, 1 carry forward. Then 8 plus 4, 12, 12 plus 3, 15 plus 3, 18 plus 1, which was carry forward. So 19, 9, 1 carry forward. Then 5 plus 2, 7 plus 2, 9 plus 6, 15 plus 4, 19 plus that 1 carry forward, 0, 2 carry forward. 8 plus 2, 10 plus 7, 17. 17 plus 4, 21. So 1, 2 carry forward and 4 plus 2, 6. So the answer is written this way, 610905. So similarly, you can see that you can take any 2-digit number like 54 times 37 and you can take the answer in this grid. So you can write 54 here, 37 here, and 5 times 3, 15 you will write here. Like that you can do this. I have given the answer in the next slide. So you can prepare this square and do this lattice method also it is called. So see 54 times 37, so 5 times 3 15, 4 times 3 12, 7 5s are 35, 7 4s are 28 and you just add diagonally you get the answer 1998. So this is the beautiful method given or discovered by Ganesh Devadnya. Now he was the astronomer and he has given that time the calendar of eclipse and 11 year cycle, he accepted the 11 year cycle of sun and he has made his own almanac preparation and his almanac was still in use till recently. So he has written 15 astronomical books and he is considered as the most brilliant astronomer of medieval India. So similarly you can, I have done another example, 427 multiplied by 563 and you can do this way if you want. Okay, so now I'll just go to next slide, which is the coding of the numbers using coding, which is called as Bakshali manuscript. This is about Kottapaya method, which was first there in the very ancient text. It was there, and afterwards this method was accepted, and it is, we can see this method in many types of literature coming. Now this method is giving codes to the different alphabets in Devanagari and converting that code. So therefore we can see that it is so using this actually there is a standard coding system which we can see that coming in many different texts. Okay, so now using this system there is a very big work done by Madhava in 15th century and this particular work is I considered it's very beautiful because we can see these, there are 7 different shlokas are there and every shlok is particularly about the description of a king or some type of environment where a king is there. But actually if you decode this, like Shreshtha Nama Varishtha Nam Himadri Veda Bhavadaha Tapano Bhana Suktadnyo Madhyamam Vidhi Dovanam. So Mrugahara Nareshayo Viro Ranajayo Sukaha. So therefore the one king who is doing the taking say deer, he is killing deer and he is always very much keen to do some type of warrior way or he do some type of or he wants to win all the time. So this is a particular description about him, but if I decode it, it is nothing but the entire sign table and actually I have tried decoding it. I've done it, and I can see that when I use lav shreshtha, so shra is taken as what it is called, if there is a coding system given here, so shra is taken like this, so whatever is you have to decode that in terms of the numbers, and you can do that. Now suppose this is no, so no is what it is, no, so if you see the no is zero, so therefore it is coming as zero. So no is coming as zero, mo is coming as four, vo is coming as two. So like this you can use it, and this is the angle in terms of minute, which we convert it to sign, and we get the entire sign table. So in this shloka, you, if you know how to decode, you can remember entire sign table. This is a wonderful example of how they used to connect literature, coding and mathematics with the help of simple type of kavya or poetry. And now we go to Kaprekar numbers. Again, Kaprekar is a very simple person from Mumbai, used to travel to Dombivli every day for his job. And while traveling from train, he has done lot of thinking about number theory, and there is a number called Kaprekar number 6174. So select any four digit number, take the maximum and create a maximum and minimum number out of that, subtract minimum number from maximum, then you will get another number, repeat the process, you will end up at 6174. So the, of course, the condition is all, at least all digits should not be repeated. You will have at least two or three different digits should be there in the number. So this is a condition. So you will get this 6174. So I have given it two examples. So 1789. So maximum number is 9871. Minimum number is 1789. When you subtract, you get 8082. So from 8082, you get maximum number 8820. Minimum number 0288. You get 8532. And with 8532, again you come to 6174. So this is a, Kaprekar has got many such work. He has contributed to number theory many things. So now this is a last world view about ancient maths. This is a very beautiful book by Kim, and considered as a major reference book now for ancient Indian maths. So entire world is now dependent on Indian numeral system along with zero, and our language of computers is also now in terms of zero and one. So I think without zero there were no existence was possible in current modern times. So therefore we can see that the invention and the significance of Indian maths, how Simon D. Laplace says about this. So it's a profound importance, and the simplicity of the methods are very much there. We appreciate those. They appreciate these methods. And in the book of Universal History of Numbers, George Ifra tells that the discovery which we take for granted, like the number system, it's like a considerable discovery, just like an invention of wheel or steam engine. So therefore it is a Indian civilization has contributed in a great amount through their mathematical and astronomical contributions. Now this is the concept of infinity. I just want to mention it because it is placed very beautifully in this shloka. As I always said, why Indians could made so much efforts and why they have done so much progression in terms of astronomy and mathematics, because there was always a spiritual angle to it, and whatever the concept in spirituality, they want to put it in the form of a numbers. Like here also, when they are explaining, Bhaskaracharya want to explain the concept of infinity, so he gives the example in spiritual literature, like the one which is ultimate. The ultimate reality is one which is never changes, never increases, never decreases, which is an infinite infinite immutable Brahman, or the Brahma is a, or the universal consciousness which we can call, just like the universal consciousness, the concept, the infinity term is there. There is no change in the Kahara, that is it. Kahara is the name of, he gives to infinity. Kha means sky and Hara means to get reduced or to become or decrease. So the one which is never decrease or it always increases till the sky is the actual meaning of Khahara term. So Khahara is like a increasing like a sky or increasing up to the sky is the meaning of this Khahara, which is a very appropriate name he has given to infinity. So Khahara Rashi or the Khahara magnitude is the magnitude which never decreases and increases up to the limit of sky, and sky has no limit, so Khahara has no limit or infinity has no limit. So therefore this is the entire, there is no change in the Khahara by addition or subtraction, just like the universal consciousness remains as it is, whatever happens in it. So like this, it has been, Bhaskaracharya has connected it to spirituality. And now this is the later, without mentioning Ramanujam, I can't end this lecture because he is the father of Pi, we can say that, and his contribution is, we still don't know how, what his work is, what or any work you take, any formula you take, it reveals something different. So this is the several formulas of Pi given by Ramanujam, and different series were there. Each series nowadays in astronomy also, Ramanujam series is applied in the work of black holes. And finally, I will end this lecture by, this is a shloka of Ishavasya Upanishad. Again, Purnam is the quantity which we can say can be zero also or can be infinity also. So most of the time, so everything Purnam Adaha, Purnam Idam, Purnat, Purnam Yajjate, Purnasya Purna Madaya, Purnam Ema Vashishyate. So the whole and the complete, from the whole this whole comes. So from the whole, if you remove, it will remain whole. If you add whole, it will remain whole. So it is another way of zero and so and infinity also. So with this, I will end this lecture. Om Shanti Shanti. And these are some of the references. There is a book in Marathi written by Professor Mohan Apte, Ancient Indian Maths, and it's a very big, very beautiful book written in Marathi language. And I'm fortunate that I got guidance of Professor Apte for this particular ancient maths and the journey of my entire mathematics, ancient mathematics career. So I am grateful for, always grateful to my guru, Professor Apte. So thank you so much. And